stories at the end of the service. So it's like, which one? What came to my mind was the one you just heard read. It's in Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Slight variations between them, about 90-95% the same. It's like, hey, Lord, now what? Then I thought about another story about 10 lepers. And I thought, well, this was a couple of days before Thanksgiving. Do you ever wonder about what happened to those 10 lepers? According to Luke's Gospel, chapter 17, the 10 came saying, Jesus, have mercy on us. And Jesus apparently had mercy and just said, go show yourselves to the priest. And they all went away, healed. Well, one came back and said, thank you. So now, 2 nights before Thanksgiving, let's think about thankfulness. Let's think about thankfulness about questions in Scripture that we have a hard time understanding. Questions we ask, why, Lord, is it written this way? Why did only one come back? What about the others? How rude. I mean, I don't know about you, but if I've been healed of leprosy, which was a dread disease that if you had it by Levitical law, Jewish law, but also by civic law, you had to be separated. You had better keep yourself far away from anybody who's healthy. If in the presence of anybody, meaning like far from me to like back row back there, I better start yelling out, leper, 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 so that you would know to stay away from me, and I would know to stay away from you. Because it was a contagious disease. Through touch, but back then they didn't know exactly how it was communicated from person to person. And so if you ever saw the 1950 version of Ben-Hur, it's the only one I've seen, there's a scene in the cave. All the people with leprosy live in the cave, and you know, their clothing is deteriorating, and their flesh is deteriorating. It was a dread, horrible disease that separated people from their family, from society. Only people that could be with other lepers. And if I had been healed, I would have been going, yeah, Lord, let me find who this man is who just said this word and say thank you. There's a great story from a Episcopal priest named Martin Bell. He wrote The Velveteen Rabbit. He also wrote a book called The Way of the Wolf. It's a collection of stories, poems, and prayers. And there's a great story in there about the other nine. We like to spend about 7 or 8 minutes sharing that story with you. Martin Bell's fantasizing about what happened to the other nine who did not return. So listen if you would prayerfully. Only one turned back in a loud voice, glorifying God, and fell down at Jesus' feet, giving thanks to him. Jesus answering said, were not 10 cleansed? But where are the nine? 10 lepers were cleansed, so one of them returned to give thanks. That must be a nice thing to be able to do. What about the other? Simple, really. One of them was frightened. That's it, just frightened. He didn't understand what had happened, and it frightened him. So he looked for some place to hide. Jesus had scared him. A second leper was offended because he had not been required to do something difficult before he could be healed. It was all too easy. He had expected months, maybe years of fasting and prayers, washing, righteous living, to meet the requirement to be healed. Maybe this special kind of secret prayers had to be prayed. But he'd done none of this. He had not earned his reward of healing. His motto was, you get what you pay for. And so Jesus, in a sense, had offended him because he hadn't paid anything for his healing. The third realized too late that he had not really wanted to be cleansed after all. But he did not know what to do or how to live without his leprosy. Although it had been his fervent plea to be healed, he now began to see how much he had needed his leprosy and consequently how necessary it had been in defining who he was as a person. Jesus had taken away his identity. It's difficult to explain the reason why the fourth leper did not return to give thanks, perhaps because it was such a simple reason. And perhaps because we very nearly tread on holy ground even to talk about it. In a word, the fourth leper did not return because in his delirium of joy, he forgot. He forgot, that's all. He was so happy that he forgot. The fifth leper was unable to say thanks or thank you to anybody anymore. There's something that happens in a person who must beg and who is shunned by his fellows, who is begrudgingly thrown a few coins now and then as a sympathy offering, a person who was always in the midst of such an existence, in the face of such treatment, expected to say thank you. But this man just doesn't say thank you to anybody anymore, not even to Jesus. The sixth leper was a woman, a mother who had been separated from her family for 11 years because of her leprosy. She was now free to rejoin her husband and children. She did not return to give thanks because she was hurrying home like a wild animal released from captivity. She had been freed by Jesus, and like that animal freed, she simply went straight home. The sellers just didn't believe that Jesus had anything to do with the cleansing. He knew the healing had taken place, but why and how were the questions. Certainly he did not believe in hocus pocus, magic, miracles, anything of that sort. There was a perfectly intelligible explanation of what had happened, but it didn't have anything to do with Jesus. He didn't return to give thanks because Jesus had nothing to do with the healing at all. The eighth leper did not return precisely because he did not believe that Jesus had healed him, that the kingdom of God had come here, and that Jesus was the Messiah who had arrived. To return to give thanks when the kingdom of God was so close at hand, unheard of. So he just ran to say the news. Hey, I got healed. Be touched by the Lord. The kingdom of God's come here. I'm well. What about the ninth leper? What was his experience? Why didn't he return? Mark Bell writes, I don't know the answer to either of these questions. All I know is that he showed himself to the priest and immediately was cleansed. He then stood still for a moment and smiled. It's impossible to say precisely why he did not return to give thanks. 10 were cleansed and only one returned. It must be nice to be able to do that. What shall I say now? That the real point is not that one returned, but the 10 were cleansed? You already know that. That condemnation is easier than investigation? That if we take time to investigate the reasons why people act as they do, we would find that they have to act the way they do? Such actions are understandable in light of their circumstances. And you understand that already as well. What then shall I say? It's good to give thanks? Yes. That's understandable not to give thanks? Yes. That God does not heal people and then stand around waiting for us to say thank you? And then get angry and have his feelings hurt if we don't say thank you? You know that may be true. Which is the same thing as saying, no, God certainly doesn't get angry. But what are the nine? They're on the way home, hiding in fear, refusing to believe, offended at what they call cheap grace, so happy they forgot. Lost without the leprosy, unable to say thanks even again, publishing the good news, the coming of the kingdom. God, you know who they are. The point is this. Jesus does know who they are. He knows where they are. First he said to the leper who did return, arise, go your way. And then he goes on his way with a strange smile on his lips. Where are the nine? Don't you see it in his eyes? Jesus knows where they are. He knew all along. Without another word, Jesus just walks away. I find that a little story that causes me to ponder about my attitude about life, when prayers are answered, when prayers are not answered, when I experience a healing or curing, when I don't. About the things I give thanks for, the things I don't give thanks for. But now back to the gospel for today. 10 lepers. Oh, no, just one leper. This is the only person in the gospels who asks Jesus a question, makes the statement. If you will, you can heal me. Only this man says that. If you will. Well, the first thing God does is, through Jesus, is make it really clear. Here's the question. Is it God's will to heal? Yes. A major obstacle for Christians is that we think God is able to heal, but we don't know if the Lord is willing to heal. We've been in that situation. I have many times. Never, ever pray yourself or let anyone pray for you for healing with these words, Lord, if it be your will, heal me. Because this story in Matthew, Mark, and Luke makes it explicitly clear that God's will is to heal. It is God's will to heal. This man took risks. Sometimes it's hard to sit out here and raise a hand and say, I want prayer. It's risky. What about sharing that secret that you have with somebody who might be a stranger? They might go off and tell somebody else. What if nothing happens? Will I get disappointed? Will I lose faith? Will I stop believing? Will I become discouraged? Lord, he said, if it's your will, you can make me clean. This man came desiring to be healed. But you know, his desire was not enough. Desire was not enough. Nothing happened until the question was cleared up. Lord, is it your will to heal me? People get prayed for a lot of times and they don't get healed. They don't get cured. Because they come hoping the Lord will heal. But they don't come expecting. The Lord is able, yes. But do we believe he's willing to heal us? We come hoping, yes. But do we come expecting? Jesus' response is, of course I want to be clean. Jesus says nothing, hey brother, you know, your religious life today has been pretty lousy. Get involved in a good Bible-believing synagogue. Study scripture, memorize it, quote it to me. I want to know that you know your scriptures and you claim the biblical promises. It's none of that. Go off, change your way of living, go forgive a bunch of people, confess your sins. There's nothing about that that Jesus said. Jesus simply says, of course I want to be healed. For many of us as Christians who do believe that the Lord heals us, we live on about 25% of our life believing that God is able. We hope that he will. But we need to change that 25%. Focus on 75% that we need to really work on. We need to go from, Lord, you're able, and I hope you will, to, Lord, I know you're willing, and I expect healing. Expectation is so important. When the 10 came to Jesus, they were expecting to be healed. When this man came, they were expecting, not hoping, expecting. How do you come tonight? Hoping or expecting? Expect. See what the Lord does. Amen. We're sharing with you a prayer by Ken and Jim Glennon. Join me in your heart in this prayer. Heavenly Father, I offer you my body that you might heal it. To enable me to do your will, I offer you my mind, that you may renew it, to focus on you as the object of my adoration and faith. I offer you all I am and have, to be what you want me to be, to do what you want me to do, so that I might fulfill your purpose for me. I ask these things in the name of him who gave himself for me, Jesus Christ my Lord. Amen. That quote from Scripture, for his compassions never fail, we have new every morning. Great is his faithfulness.